MedCram.
Okay, so welcome to another MedCram lecture. This is part three of acute renal failure. We talked about BUN and creatinine and how to use it. And I think that's a good background for what we're going to get into next. And what we're going to get into next is the different types of renal failure. I'm going to kind of divide the screen into thirds, okay? Because there are three basic major types of acute renal failure, and they're aptly named. One is called pre-renal failure, one is just called renal failure, and the other one is post-renal failure. And we're going to get into what these things mean. Okay, so you've got the kidneys, you've got blood coming to the kidneys, and then the kidneys make urine, and the urine goes out through the ureter down to the bladder, through the bladder, and then out through the urethra, and then outside. So if there's any obstruction, okay, any obstruction from the ureter in the bladder and the urethra, that's going to be a post-renal failure type of situation. If there's any problem with the kidney itself, and I'm talking about the tubular cells, I'm talking about the glomerulus, the tubular cells, the collecting tubule, any of that stuff, then it's renal. If there's a problem with the blood getting to the kidney, so if you're talking about congestive heart failure, renal artery stenosis, hypovolemia, hypotension, any of that kind of stuff, you're going to get a pre-renal azotemia kind of situation. So what are some things here that could cause pre-renal? Let's talk about pre-renal first. So any kind of, if there's decreased cardiac output, hypovolemia, okay? How about renal artery stenosis? We'll just abbreviate RAS. So anything that prevents blood from getting to the kidneys is going to cause that. Well, what about renal? What causes renal problems? Well, how about medications? There's tons of medications that'll cause renal failure. Let's name a few. What about aminoglycosides? So those are antibiotics. What about NSAIDs? Okay, how about ACE inhibitors? ACEI. These are hypertensive medications. So there's a whole host of things. What about just necrosis? Acute tubular necrosis. What's acute tubular necrosis? Well, if there's not enough blood reaching the kidney, at first you're going to have a pre-renal situation. But if that lasts for a long period of time, long enough, by hours or day, you can actually get something called acute tubular necrosis where there's just not enough blood that reached the kidney, there was no oxygen, and the cells died. And usually this is a reversible situation, but you can certainly see ATN. And so a lot of times what you're going to be doing is trying to determine, is this renal failure? In other words, is it so bad that, was the hypotension so bad for so long that we have renal failure, or is it just temporary enough that we're dealing with pre-renal failure? And we'll talk about how you can figure out the difference between the two. Post-renal failure is pretty easy. The most common cause is just prostate, okay? So specifically in men, the prostate is so large, it's choking off the urethra, and the bladder can't empty, and this backs up into the ureter, and it causes what we call hydronephrosis. So this is water on the kidney. But there's other things that can do this. Cervical cancer. Okay, cervical cancer can spread out to the ureter and cause an obstruction. Tumors, any kind of tumors out there, or just anything that's going to block the body's ability to get rid of urine. Kidney stones can do it. And so there's several different ways that you can go into acute renal failure. So you have to figure that out. Okay, so let's concentrate for the moment on these two here, pre-renal and renal. Those are the two I want to concentrate on. So imagine you are a kidney, and if you were in a situation like this, okay, imagine your situation, you're a kidney and not enough flow is coming down the pike, not enough blood is coming down to your glomerulus. Basically, you understand that as simply meaning that there's not enough volume in the body. And so what are you going to do in this situation? You're going to want to hold on to as much salt and sodium as possible. And the reason is because volume in the body is determined by the kidney's ability to reabsorb salt. And so if you've got your glomerulus, so I'm going to draw a little tiny nephron here, okay? And you've seen this before, no doubt. Okay, so you've got that, you've got your afferent arterial coming in and then going out. You are going to make sure that every single tubule that you have at your disposal is reabsorbing sodium. Okay, so that's going to be very important. And so that the urine that's coming out, is it going to be high in sodium or is it going to be low in sodium? Well, if you're trying to take all the sodium out of that urine as much as possible and getting it back into the blood so your body can get more volume, you can bet that the urinary concentration of sodium is going to be low. Okay? But as the sodium goes, so does the water go with it. So sodium gets reabsorbed, water gets reabsorbed with it. What's the concentration of your urine going to be? So what's the urine osmolarity, OSM? It's going to be high. Does that make sense? So again, let's review that. If you've got a nephron which is not getting a lot of flow, it's going to anticipate that you're going to need more volume. And so it's going to reabsorb sodium, which is the key for getting volume. Sodium gets reabsorbed, water follows it. And so what you have is a low urine sodium because that's what's left. And what's left is going to be very concentrated because all the sodium in the water is going to be taken out. And so you're going to be left with all of the other things like the urea, for instance, and all the other things that the body gets rid of in the urine. So the concentration is going to be quite high. Now, this is in contradistinction to what we see over here on the renal side. Again, let's go ahead and make our glomerulus. Okay. Here the situation is different. Here we've got the flow coming down, no problem, but the kidneys themselves, the tubule cells are not working. So if these tubules are not working, tell me, are they reabsorbing sodium and water? The answer is no. So they're not. And so what are you going to see in the urine that passes by? You're going to have urine sodium concentration is going to be high. Why is that? Because the cells are not doing their job. They're not reabsorbing sodium like they should. And as a result of that, water is not being reabsorbed. And so the urine osmolarity is going to be low. And specifically, it's going to be around that of the serum. And it's going to be 1.010, otherwise known as 1010. Okay, so high urine sodium, high urine osmolality. So we get over here to postrenal. And what we usually see is that early on, it appears as though it looks like prerenal, okay? Whereas later on, when the kidney actually starts to fail, it looks actually more like renal, okay? So let's go over a couple of things that will show you how to determine and how to figure out what's going on with patients who come in with acute renal failure. Okay, So for post-renal failure, it's pretty easy to figure that when a patient comes in. So for post-renal, what you do is you put a urinary catheter in. So if you catheterize the patient, put a catheter in, otherwise known as a Foley catheter, and a whole bunch of urine comes out, and the patient's relieved and the renal failure resolves, then it was probably post-renal. So these are pretty easy to figure out. You can get an ultrasound of the kidney. You could put a Foley in. There's several ways of figuring out where the problem is. So if you remember the anatomy, you've got the kidneys, okay, and you've got the ureters coming down, okay, and they go into a bladder, and then the bladder empties out into urethra. So there's several different places where you could have an obstruction. You can have an obstruction here in the ureter, or you could have an obstruction here in the urethra. If you place a Foley catheter, which goes up the urethra and into the bladder, and there's a lot of residual, there's a lot of fluid in there, and all of it comes out, well, then you've got your answer. If you do an ultrasound, okay, and you see that these kidneys are large because there's an obstruction here or down here, then you can also make that determination as well. So ultrasound, Foley catheter, you can make the diagnosis of post-renal pretty well. Also, if this patient has a history of prostate problems and it's difficult to pass the Foley, all of these are signals that what you're dealing with here is a post-renal failure. So I don't want to focus too much on that, because what you're going to find most of your time trying to figure out is the difference between renal and pre-renal. So let's talk about that. Okay, so let's talk about pre-renal versus renal. So we're going to split the board here in two, and we're going to look at those. So let's put pre-renal up here. Pre-renal, again, is where the heart is not pumping enough blood, or there isn't enough blood, or there's a stenosis to the artery that's going to the kidney. Basically, there's a problem before the kidney, or pre-renal. Okay, then let's talk about renal over here. Okay, so let's look at different categories. What about the urine osmolarity? So what do we say here? The urine osmolarity in pre-renal is usually going to be greater than 500, whereas in renal, it's going to be less than 350. Why is that again? Because in pre-renal, you're trying to hold on to sodium and water as much as possible. You're trying to take every drop of sodium chloride and water out of that filtrate, and what you're left with is a very concentrated urine. With renal, on the other hand, your tubules are not working. And so as a result of that, you're letting stuff pass right through. And so the osmolality or the osmolarity is very similar to that of blood. And as you recall, blood osmolality is around 295. So it's going to be very similar to what you're getting out of the kidney. Another way of saying this is the specific gravity. Specific gravity you'll see in pre-renal is usually greater than 1.010. The specific gravity in renal failure is about 1.010. In fact, we call it 1010. This could get up as high over here, by the way, as 1.030. That's pretty concentrated urine there. All right, so the other thing we can look at is we can actually measure the urinary sodium concentration. So the urinary sodium concentration, what do you think it's going to be in pre-renal? It's going to be low, that's right. So it's going to be less than about 20. Whereas in renal, you're going to see usually greater than 40. You can actually order that as a lab and see. What about sediment? Okay, what's happening? What's sediment mean? Sediment is simply dead cells from the kidney sloughing off and finding their way, ending up in the urine. Would you expect to see sediment in a pre-renal situation? The answer is no, you wouldn't. Remember here, what's the problem? The problem is there's not enough blood and fluid getting to the kidneys. And as a result of that, those cells, those very cells that we're talking about there, are working overtime to try to get sodium chloride up. Now, if this goes on for long enough and is severe enough, the cells could die. Then you switch over and you become renal, because when they die, the cells are not working anymore. And so they slough off and you do get positive sediment. And that's more of a renal phenomenon. Finally, we get to the crux here, and that's the BUN to creatinine ratio. So what do we see with a BUN creatinine ratio? Remember, in pre-renal, BUN gets increased because it's not being filtered as much, but it also goes up for another reason, because it's being reabsorbed to the proximal convoluted tubule. So typically, our BUN to creatinine ratios are greater than 20, whereas over here on the renal side, they are usually less than or equal to 15. Now, there's one other thing that I would like to bring up, and that's something that you might see called the FINA. Okay, FINA. What's a FINA? Well, let me clear the screen and show you. The FINA stands for the fractional excretion of sodium of the kidney. And the equation goes something like this. It is the concentration of sodium in the urine over the concentration of sodium in the plasma all over the concentration of creatinine in the urine over the concentration of creatinine in the plasma. Complicated, yes, but here's the key thing I want you to zoom in on, and that is this factor right here. We've already said, and you know this just algebraically, that if this number is high, that this number is going to be high, just algebraically. And so what kind of a type of renal failure causes you to have a high urine sodium concentration? Is it pre-renal or is it renal? It's renal because the cells are dead. So what you'll see if we go back and split our screen here, we got pre-renal and we got renal, that if you've got a situation with a FeNA, okay, your pre-renal is usually going to be less than 1.0 if you calculate this whole thing, okay? Whereas with renal, it's usually going to be greater than 2%. Okay, these are both percents. It's going to be lower in the pre-renal because your urine sodium is going to be low in the pre-renal. And why is that? Because the kidney is trying to reabsorb as much salt and water as possible. Okay, so this concludes acute renal failure and how to interpret creatinine, BUN, those sorts of things. I thank you for joining me.